நிமிஷமோட லைன்ல வந்தாங்க சார்,
அதுக்கப்புறம் நித்யானந்தா.
Respected Professor Nadarajan and my dear Mr. Venkatramani and then beloved student and friend Mr. Janardhanan, Mr. Suresh and all participants involved in this memorable webinar. Good morning to everybody. See, it's an interesting webinar and we all meet together. And you know, I will introduce my friend, Mr. Nadarajan. You know, I know him for the last 2 decades. More than 2 decades, I know him. Yes. He started his career in the city of Chennai. Chennai. Yes, I met him several times in CSIR complex, naturally engineering research center, and then when the institute moved to Delhi, Central Institute of Science, Communication and Industry at Research, he joined there, he secured his bachelor's from Chennai to Delhi. Yeah, he is a multifaceted person, I should say, in a single branch. And he is not only an editor of the Journal of Scientific and Industrial Research.
1 minute, sir.
And he is also, associate professor in the Department of Library and leading to associateship in Documentation Research Training Center. He was a teacher, a practicing librarian, and as well as an editor and principal scientist, NISCA. And you know, after his superannuation, he joined Jinnah University, Ethiopia, and served there more than 3 years, I believe. Yeah. And you know, to be in short, he is a nice person, approachable person, and as well as good culture and whatnot. As far as my knowledge is concerned, he is very friendly with each and everybody. He is very strong in PR and HR. Yeah. So, with this small introduction, I will hand over this session to Mr. Venkatramani, Secretary Mala. Please, Mr. Venkatramani, please.
Dr. Nijaman, sir, Dr. Nadarajan, Janardhanan, Tirunagarasu, and Suresh, Librarian Law College, Trichinopoly, and these executive members of Mala, and my dear friends, students, and other audience who are attending the program. I know Nadarajan for the last 20-25 years when he was working in INSDOC in Chennai, and subsequently has moved to New Delhi. And now the INSDOC has been changed as NISCAR, and he worked in NISCAR and retired. And after retirement also he has taken up associate professor in University of Jinnah, Ethiopia. And he was unassumingly simple person and used to move very friendly with everyone. And he was the editor of Journal of Scientific and Industrial Research, and he published number of articles in Desktop Bulletin. And I welcome, when I approached him for delivering the webinar, yes, I readily agreed for this. I thank him for his accepting my invitation to give a webinar for the benefit of the Mala members. I request Mr. Tirunagarasu to talk about it. To read out its property.
voice is not clear, I believe.
Voice is not clear.
Now it's okay, I think.
Yeah.
Good morning everyone. Today is our resource person, Dr. M. Nadarajan. He's a senior, retired senior principal scientist, NISCAR. He joined National Scientific Documentation Center, NIST, INSTAL, in 1981 and continued up to June 2014, more than 33 years of experience. Dr. M. Nadarajan holds a PhD in Library and Information Science, and also he did MSc Max BLIS, all from University of Madras. He did Associateship in Documentation and Information Science course from Indian Statistics Institute, DRTC, Bangalore. He also passed MBA HR from Sikkim Manipal University. He also possesses PG diploma courses like PG diploma in Educational Administration and Supervision, PG diploma in Computer Applications, DTP Professional Plus, and PG diploma in Computer Systems and Design, and PG diploma in Journalism and Mass Communication. Also, he passed certificate courses in Italian and French languages. He worked in various divisions of NISCAR, Chennai, Bangalore, and Delhi, including SDI service, document copy supply, information retrieval from STN and Dialog, SIRNet, MALIBNet, Indian Science Abstracts, Library Automation Projects, NUCSI, National Science Digital Library, Publications, and also he is an editor for JSIR, Head of Education and Training Division. He also worked as regional director for INSTAG, Chennai and Bangalore. And he conducted many short-term courses at INSTAG, Delhi and Chennai also. So he conducted UGC recognized refresher course for Library and Information Science 5 times, wherein 127 librarians have been trained. Also, he delivered invited lectures in many institutions, universities in India, including CIFRI, MPCST, DAV College, Nagpur, Delhi University, Madras University, like that. Also, his professional interest, anything in LIS related, including social media. He is retired on 30th June 2014, visited many countries like Ethiopia, Egypt, Qatar, Dubai, Turkey, Nepal, and other places. He's been to Jinmah University, Ethiopia, and worked as Associate Professor in Information Science for BSc and guided students for the research and e-learning. Research guide at 6 universities in India, and 3 students have been awarded so far. 2 are in the process. Published more than 207 papers in national and international conferences, journals, also written book chapters 9, edited books 3, book reviewed 5, and published a book on knowledge management, challenges and application. He guided a research product dissertation done for 101 students in AASI, AIS, PGDLAN, MPhil, MLIS, BSc, so far. He is an editorial board member for 15 journals and the reviewer for 26 journals in the world. He also a life member of many professional associations like in India, like AIS, Mysore, DLA, ILA. Rajan to deliver his webinar. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Are you, good morning to all of you. Are you hearing, sir? Sir, are you hearing, sir?
Can you, sir? Can you, sir?
Sound is coming.
Sound is coming. That's what I'm okay.
Very good morning to all of you. Very good morning to all of you.
Sir, other than Dr.
Yes, sir.
Other than Dr. Nadarajan, sir, everyone, please mute your audio. Everyone, mute your audio. Other than Dr. Nadarajan.
So very good morning to all of you. I pray the Almighty to be everyone safe and healthy in the COVID-19 pandemic situation. Hope all are fine. It's my proud moment to be a part of webinar being conducted by Mala with LIS Quiz. I am thankful for the nice introduction to the listeners of the webinar to Mr. Thirunavakar. Welcome to today's webinar on Big Data and the role of HRM. Thank you for taking out and being here today for this webinar. So as it was told, I am Dr. Natarajan, retired from ISCARE, having more than 39 years of experience and currently working as a consultant in the Asia Pacific Institute of Management. So I am thankful to President Mala and convener and my dear friend Dr. K. Nityanandam and the organizing secretary of this webinar, Mr. T.C. Thirunavakar, and the web coordinator, Mr. P.L. Janarthanan, secretary Mr. Venkat Ramani, and Mr. Suresh, member from Trichy, and to the organizing team as well. So LIS professionals throughout the country are conducting webinars and sharing their knowledge among young, budding, and growing LIS students and other LIS professionals. My sincere thanks to one and all, including this team, who is contributing professionally very nicely. My best wishes to continue, and I want to give some suggestion to include some topics in the future. Some of the topics I just want to mention: mobile apps to libraries, e-learning, online learning, Internet of Things, virtual reality applications, artificial intelligence applications, library 4.0, challenges faced for innovative services, because many people talk about innovative services in 21st century. But while introducing those innovative services, what are the challenges they face? That may be one of the talk also. And maybe the question answer will be done after the webinar, maybe 6 to 7 questions selectively. So with this, I just want to start my presentation. Thank you once again for all. Thirunavakar, the slide is showing on the screen. Hello, Mr. Thirunav. Slide is displaying.
Slide is displaying. Okay. Yes, okay. We are able to read the slide.
Okay, so role of big data in HRM. So the introduction part, just to mention some of the concept of big data and why it is required. So big data was coined by Roger Margolis in 2000.
Sir. Yeah. Yes,
it was okay. It was coined by Roger Margolis in 2005. It refers to data sets whose size is beyond the ability of typical database software tools to capture, store, manage, and analyze. This is what is told by McKinsey Global Institute. Because it's not the normal data where you can immediately capture and store and manage, because the data sets are more. That is why it is somewhat difficult, and typical type of databases or software tools are required to manage those things. So data is increasing exponentially everywhere, and about 90% of the data are not captured actually, or even if it is captured, they are not analyzed, because the data, whatever is captured, that should be analyzed and make it in a meaningful form for use it. Then only that is called a big data. There are many data which are available here and there, which is not analyzed, and that is, we cannot count as a big data unless otherwise it is analyzed and used for some purpose. So data is like a collection of symbols, figures, which have no value, but when it is interpreted, remembered, and used to forecast future. Similarly, data management, it is growth in volume, and different types of data is there. You know, numerical data, structured data, unstructured data, I think it's the next paragraph. Big data analytics refers to the process of collecting, analyzing, those unstructured and semi-structured data to find out the correlation between them. Patterns and useful information, those are helpful for decision making and needed for future growth of any organization or system. Due to this, it is to find out the role of big data for human HR activity.
Slide is not moving.
Okay, that is Tarunakaras is doing, sir, from there.
Main slide mattumna theriyudhu. Please, Tirunagar sir, please adjust. Slide is not visible. Only first slide, title page is not visible. Slide is not moving. Now it is
working. Yes, again, I said
no. Yeah, next slide. Next, after introduction, next slide. Definitions. Next one. Next, Tirunagar sir. Next, slightly move. Definitions of big data. Still move up. Yes. Yeah. Big data.
Simply, definition, sir.
Yeah, definitions. It's a very large collection, either set, either textual or numeric data, because data can be numerical as well as textual, or nowadays because of images are there, audio, video, or so any type of data will be a big data. Is that because it has to be reused after analyzing. You see, for analyzing the data, you get some interpretation. From that, you can make use of that. Dana Boyd and Carte Crawford, they define big data as a cultural, technological, and scholarly phenomenon that rests on the interplay of those things. See, by technology, how it is using is maximizing the computation power. Because the data is very big, it is not easy to do by normal system or other things. So you need a better system and better infrastructure. That is why it is called maximizing computation power and algorithmic accuracy to gather as well as analyze and link and compare those large data sets. And analysis, drawing on large data sets to identify patterns. What are the patterns it is following in order to make it to benefit for economic, social, technical, and legal claims. And as a mythology, the widespread belief that large data sets offer a higher form of intelligence and knowledge that can generate insights that were previously impossible with the aura of truth, objectivity, and accuracy. Next slide. The sources of big data. Next slide, please. Can I move from here? No. Next slide. Yeah, sources of big data. See, the data is available everywhere, you can say, the big data, but we are not finding nowadays it is possible to find out. And so it has got many it has got many different sources. For example, every mouse click on a website, see, when we are clicking for each and every link or browsing or again searching, whatever we do, or typing some text, every mouse click can be captured as a log file and they can be analyzed to understand what we are doing. If somebody is interested to buy something from the market or a big bazaar or some marketing, so that can be, when he does whatever he does using the system, the log files can be analyzed. Then we can find out what are the things he is trying to buy. The buying behaviors we can identify from that after analyzing those log files. So that way it is to better understand shoppers' buying behavior and to influence their shopping by dynamically recommending the products. So the big data may be available in different sources like online shopping, airlines, hospital data, mobile phones, nuclear experiments. The NCDC is a National Climatic Data Center, so climatic information. The sensors, CCTV cameras, social media. So many places, wherever you, nowadays the data is generated in every corner of the movement of the people. So next slide, please. So the example of the generation of data. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Generation of big data. Yeah. So this is an example of a data generating organization and the amount of big data data generated everywhere. If you find IBM, every day, see 2.2 trillion bytes of data is generated. Power consumption, 350 billion annual meter reading. Walmart, you know, the biggest shopping place, 2.5 petabytes of data per hour. And Google, 4 million search queries per minute. Facebook, 100 terabytes per data per day. In a flight, see, 240 terabytes of a flight data during single flight across US. On Twitter, 2.7 lakh tweets. Instagram, 2.16 photos. On Vine, there's where videos are uploaded. More than 8,000 videos are uploaded per minute. So like that, see, the data is growing everywhere. That's a, this is a generation of big data. The next one, please. The value of big data. Next slide, please. Sirana, next slide, please. Yeah. So value of big data. So you must have seen in the very beginning, only volume, velocity, and variety was the three V's were there. Later on, one by one increasing, now it is up to 10 V's have come for the value of big data. See the volume, the size of the data, that is what. Then the velocity, how fast it is generating and reaching. The speed at which the data is generated, that's the velocity. Again, the variety of data. See the different varieties of data from different data sets. Maybe numerical data, textual data, or weather data, or any mathematical data. So different varieties of data. And veracity, the accuracy of those data. And then value, the usefulness of those data. So there are five V's on one side. On the other side, the validity. See, one has to think of whatever you collect, those data should have some value and validity. So data quality hona chahiye. Then governance, master data management. So variability, so dynamic, you know, the data is go on changing. You know, the same place you will find the arithmetic data, you may find numeric data, you may find textual data, you may find video data, audio video. So you have to think of all the variable formats of data, big data, variability, dynamic. Evolving behavior in data source. And then Venue, from where you are getting it. Distributed heterogeneous data from multiple platforms. And then vocabulary, the type of language or semantic relationship among the data. So data models, semantics that describe the structure of data. And then vagueness, maybe there's some confusion over meaning of big data and the tools used. So there are 10 V's now. Maybe it is now, maybe somebody else must have found even more than 10 also, but as long as I have seen, this is up to 10 is the maximum. So the next one is about that. We need tools for using the big data. See, when you collect data, we have seen the definition of big data and the value of that and from where it is generated, then how it can be analyzed or what are the tools available for that. So now next slide, please. So big data tools, there are many tools available. I just put some of the open source tools as well as some commercial tools. So Cambridge Semantics is one of the tool that is using the ANSO software suite. There is a software called ANSO. This is an open source, open platform. It helps to collect. See, one has to first collect the data. That is very important. Then integrate with the existing one and analyze the big data from multiple sources and customize as per your dashboard. Similarly, Adobe, I think this is the first one which everybody knows. It is an open source for the big data. Adobe is open source software to handle big data developed by Apache Software Foundation, written in Java language. This helps for reliable, scalable, distributed computing of large data sets across clusters of computers using simple programming models. So there are only SQL and Apache is used there. So by using that, Hadoop is helpful for big data purpose. So another one is SQL compliant, that is called Splice Machine. It is SQL 99 compliant with the standard ANSI SQL, and it can scale from gigabytes to petabytes of data. So it supports for .NET, Java, and Python. You can nowadays, you are finding most of the places .NET and Python is growing in everywhere. So to derive real-time actionable insights. So the Splice Machine is used as a tool. Another one is called Mark Logic. It is built to deal with heavy data loads and allows users to access it through real-time updates and alerts. It's a real-time, so you can continuously update your data. It provides geographical data, because GPSS data is one which is continuously required. If somebody is interested, somebody is flying on a flight or something, there is a fight with the rocket or the helicopter needs the path. So it is a continuous data is required. They can monitor through this. So with the content and location relevance along the data filtering tools. So next screen, please. So another, it is continuation is Google Charts. Always we find everything under Google. So Google Charts. Next slide, please. So Google Charts, that is also a kind of a big data tool. The capability for visualizing data from a website. So from the website, it is visualizing and collecting the data, because normally everybody is accessing Google from some website. So it searches from there and get the data, such as hierarchical tree maps or just a simple charts. Easily implemented by embedding JavaScript code. So they try to use the JavaScript and embed it and then make it on the website. And it allows you to sort, modify, and filter the data. So they try to get some output from that. So from the web page, as we have seen, for a shopper, how he is doing, what is his behavior on the web page, what is he searching from, where is he traveling, what is the distance, suppose he searched from his house to Big Bazaar or whatever the shopping mall is going. So how many times he has gone in a month? So what are the materials he is buying? Suppose he can prepare a list of items to be purchased, or he may place the order online. So we can get all those data, then we can find out the behavior. So like this in the Google chart, it identifies and collects all the data from the website. It allows you to sort, modify, and filter data, as well as the ability to connect to your database or pull data from the website. And then SAP in memory. So SAP's HANA platform, it offers the ability to integrate and analyze large workloads of data to be analyzed in real time. Another one is called Mango database. It's an open source database, ideal for developers who want to have precise control over the final results. So those who are very much interested to find out the actual results of the final state, they try to use this open source database called MangoDB. Then Pentaho. It joins data integration. That means data is integrated for analytics, that is business analytics, for visualizing, analyzing, and blending big data with data mining and predictive analysis. So in data integration, visualizing, analyzing, and blending big data. So the predictive analysis is nothing but encompassing a variety of statistical techniques. I mean, you are analyzing many things at one place using different type of statistical techniques, from data mining or predictive modeling or machine learning or artificial intelligence, to analyze those things at the current and historical fact to make the predictions for the future. That is what the predictive analysis. Then another tool is called Talent. It's an open studio, like other than MS and Microsoft. The other one is there, this is a Talent Open Studio, which includes products for developing, testing, and deploying data management and application integration. So there are two more tools I just put. Tableau. The next screen, please. It's a well-known in data visualization sphere. See, for visualizing the data, Tableau is mostly used, but it offers many tools for developers that are supported by an active community. Because it's an open source, many people are participating in that. So we are able to get any doubts, anything, clarifications. The key features are its memory analytics database and advanced query language. So query is very much important to retrieve the actual data from the big data. So API, application program interface, XML, user script, Python and JavaScript, these are all supported, and so are a number of browser extensions are supported by this Tableau. The other one is called Splunk. It specializes typically in harnessing machine data created from a number of different sources, such as websites, applications, and sensors. So it is taking many data at one place and harness it. So the company also enables developers to write code using any technology platform, any language or frameworks. So about HRM, so we are just seeing what is big data, how it is generated, where it is available, and the tools available. Now we are just going to see about HRM, human resource management. Yeah, big data has an extensive impact at the social level, organizational level, and individual level. Because when you collect data and organize and analyze and you get some output, it may be helpful for the society, it may be helpful for the organization for which the data is collected and utilized, maybe for a better increase in some product or something. Similarly, at the individual level, you want to improve your training program, your capabilities, so you can, the big data can be utilized. So big data transforms the way people are working, in particular HR department, and after this change influences every employee in the organization. So there is a lot of changes occurring because of the big data. HRM is the process of managing employees, you know, human resource management, you know, the managing the resources of human. That is what the process of managing employees in a company with issues related to employees, hiring, motivating, training, development, giving compensation, motivation, communication, and maintaining workforce in an organization. So the process of managing employees dealt with so many related activities, starting from the hiring the people and then motivating them to carry out the activity, whatever we are giving to them, then training them to do the activity and development, then giving compensation means the salary or increment or any other benefits. Again, motivation for by themselves, they can also say this is what we want to do. So, and then communication is a must in HRM, and then maintaining the workforce is managing the things. So 7 major functions of HR normally. Strategic management, see, that's at the planning stage. Workforce planning and employment, recruitment and selection. Human resource development, that's the training and development. Total rewards, that is compensation and benefits. Policy formulation, employee and labor relations, and then risk management. So there are 7 major functions for the HR. So 3 major roles, administrative role, operational role, and strategic level. So HRM plays a strategic role in managing the people and the workplace culture and environment. To come back to big data analytics, how the big data analytics is going to enter into HRM. Business intelligence, you know, is a broad category of applications, technologies, and processes for gathering, storing, accessing, and analyzing the data. So that is a business intelligence, collecting the, gathering the data, storing and accessing, using applications and technology, and analyze those data to help business users for better decisions. This is what is given by Watson in 2009. So business intelligence evolved from decision sciences, you know, decision support system. So business intelligence can also be viewed as getting data in. I mean, you are collecting data, that is to a data mart or a warehouse. Similarly, you are getting out of data, that is after getting the data, analyzing it, getting the output. Getting data out, that is analyzing the data that is stored. The second interpretation of the analytics is that it is the getting data out part of business intelligence. The third interpretation is analytics is the use of rocket science, the algorithm, like machine learning, neural networks data. So it will be very fast, you know, the use to analyze those data. So from decision support system to business analytics. The decision support system started in 1970s. The business intelligence came in 1990s. Now business analytics has come into 2010 onwards. So business intelligence and HR. Business intelligence tools can help you combine the data because that is the purpose of intelligence. So it aggregates the data, visualize the data, analyze the data. We are just going in detail. Aggregating data is nothing but collecting everything together. Most HR reporting consists of ad hoc reporting. Business intelligence tools help in the aggregation of data and enable automatic reporting. Then visualizing the data, most of the HR systems that are transactional systems are the data that describe an event using a time dimension and a value that refers to one or more objects. The candidate is hired on a certain date and the employee's contract is terminated on a certain date. That's an example. So you have a time dimension in that. That's a visualization and the value. So business intelligence tools are really good at aggregating data from multiple systems and visualizing that. So analyze data. The final step is data analytics. Business intelligence tools are much better at analyzing the data than your average HR system. So examples here, the statistical analysis systems, they enable to statistically analyze large quantities of data. So there are some, the business intelligence tools are made to aggregate, visualize, analyze, and report that data. So that's the main purpose, is analyzing and then finding out the results and report to the respective division or respective organization. So importance of HR activity. Next one, please. So HR now focuses more on value addition and need for aligning HR activities with planning. So always HR feels we should have some value addition. See, if you just have some persons in the organization, they see that first they give some training and they add something more to him. So when he's just joined, he has been given some activity to do. He carries on for 1 year or 2 years. Then he has given some additional responsibility. That's the value addition. So that is aligning with the planning. See, always there is a planning. There's a strategic planning in HR. So HR functions in organizations that emphasize human capital that establishes business partnership with the line manager. So there is a relationship among the HRs who have direct interest and involvement in delivering the HR. So the HR functionaries become an integral part of the strategic business. So naturally in every organization, HR became a part, and customized HR solutions to provide fast and efficient services. And HRM is a valuable asset of an organization and being considered in the light of sustainability. So HR professionals must analyze social, economic, political, legal, and technological environment opportunities to redesign the HRM process. So naturally, every time, every year or every 6 months and 6 months, they try to do redesigning their activity, considering the social, economic, and political and technological environment. And practices that are the key success factors to the organization, mission, and objective. So the HR should always consider what is their organization mission and vision, or the objectives, and how it is changing is happening because of the social and economic and political and technological environment. Accordingly, they have to change over. So same thing, whenever they collect the data, the big data also has to be changed, you know, as per the environment. So just away, I go to some of the examples of big data and libraries because we are concerned with library science. So big data and libraries. Corporate librarians, next slide please. Corporate librarians need to know how companies hold big data and the data mining techniques. So in a business environment, maybe see if you take an example of L&T as a corporate library. So you should know, I mean the librarian should know what the company is doing, because then only he will be able to identify what is required for the people, what type of data is generated. See, the L&T is dealing with so many activities, starting from infrastructure to finance to software to so many things. You know, so starting from maybe construction is the beginning. I mean, base for L&T construction, everywhere you will find L&T software is there. So how the big data is generated at different places, at different methods, the data is generated. The librarian should know, then he can capture and he should analyze in what way he can improve by using the data mining techniques. So digital archivists, data curators, and other type of librarians are also asked to advise their faculty on the storage and accessibility of big data sets. So archivists, what they do, they normally store the data, you know, in the preservation or the National Museum or National Archives of India. So National Library of Calcutta also have a division of preservation section where people are working as curators or archivists. So they are advised to how to store the big data sets. So they should also seek those advices. Library managers should examine the types of big data sets they should be gathering and analyzing using the tools. So library managers should be able to identify what types of big data sets are coming up from each and every divisions or every aspect, then gather those things and analyze using the tools. So identify the massive data set related to faculty research. So this is another way of improving the research in an organization. So you should identify what is your organization's objective and what are the ways the industry, if it is an industry, the Naji sir, hello. Naji,
Hello.
Vengatramani phone பண்ணாரா என்ன?
யாருங்க?
Vengatramani phone பண்ணாரா?
Vengatramani phone பண்றாரா?
ஆ.
நான் என்னன்னு
கேக்குறேன். சரி.
இல்ல நான்
நீங்க என்ன பேசறீங்க? Sir, you can continue the session. Don't attend any other phone unless I talk to you.
Hello, Vengatramani. Ah, சொல்லுங்க என்ன ஆச்சு சார்? ஓஹோ இல்ல சார், இதெல்லாம் இதெல்லாம் பேசுங்க, பேசுறது நான் இந்த போன் சைட்ல தான். ரைட், ஓகே. ஆ எஸ் ஸ்தர்னா கர்சு வாஸ் சேயிங் சம்திங்.
சோ யூ டோன்ட் டாக் டு எனிஒன், யூ கேன் கண்டினியூ யுவர் செஷன்.
ஓகே ஓகே ஓகே. சோ பிக் டேட்டா அண்ட் லைப்ரரிஸ், we are talking about how the librarians or archivists are able to gather data and how the tools are used for them, the big data tools, and get the output, and that will be helpful for the society as for the organization's objectives. So the library manager should examine the types of big data sets they should be gathering and analyzing using the tools. Identify the massive data set related to the faculty research. I was discussing about the research aspect in an organization. If it is an industry, you must be aware there are R&D sections in the industry. So the people are some specialized people. Those, I think they recruit only the PhD people in the R&D division in that subject. Suppose if it is in a Reddy's laboratory, biology or biomedicine or such type of people, you know, because they work for medicine, pharmacy. So those people are employed and they try to do the research. You know, a lot of research is going on medicine or pharmaceutical aspects. So those data sets has to be collected by that type of librarian, and he can analyze in what way they are doing it. So the data set related to faculty research, similarly in a university environment also, because in a university, you know, there are different subject groups are there, you know, the different department, I mean, say department of physics, chemistry, management, library science. So there are many departments, so you should be able to get data from each division and then try to use that. So identify the massive data set related to the faculty research which previously was not out of the reach, because previously the research was done manually and now everything is available on software or it is available in e-format. It is easy to analyze and get that. So the hardware constraints were also there in earlier days. So use of big data can also be done for developing library collection. See, this is another very important aspect. Morning I was reading one article for collection development 2.0. there I have seen that how the big data is utilized. So for collection development, the example is what they have given is you collect data for some type of, you just give an advertisement, the following books are needed for library, give some concession fee. So there are different publishers, they try to give you the data, maybe say hundreds of publishers in an online environment. You will find at least some 25 publishers are giving price list. So those things can be analyzed very easily using the big data techniques. So updating public spaces and tracking the use of library materials. See, similarly, how you can identify how the resources are utilized by the people, different type of users. So this is given by Bayregal. There's a reference only. Big data and libraries continuation. Next slide. So big data analytics that could be also applied in the following areas of libraries for superior search result. You know, people are doing searching, you know, from the publisher's database. That is, once you subscribe for the consortium or some of the publisher's website as a database, you are having the e-resources on your library. So users are given searching facility. You know, they try to search from Emerald or Science Direct or Taylor and Francis, John Wiley, yes. So as per your subscription, people are able to do the searching. From that, you can collect the data mining text, data mining and text analytics for the past records. From the past records, you can identify in what way they are going on. So the book bibliographies, they can enhance your search result, and you can recommend to them something in a book form, or give them some related websites for better results. And demand analysis, it would help in forecasting demand for new existing titles. So the demand analysis is already you are running your organization with some subjects. So, but your institute is planning to include some more titles, some more subject area, or they are going to introduce some more courses. So there is a new demand of documents or the resources. It may be print form or e-form. So for all those things, you should be also forecast. Planning library collection. The technology used would optimize to plan the category mix in the collection by taking into consideration the space and budget constraints. So you have to think, whenever you want to develop your collection, you should first consider the space availability and budget. See, without budget, you cannot do anything. So big data in HR. The next slide, please. So HR analytics. Next slide, please. So HR analytics is a way to generate valuable insights into the workforce. So this can be done through the use of data sets that are larger than most HR professionals have ever worked. So this is the essence of big data in HR. That is, general HRM is like, as everybody know, what is HRM? Planning, recruitment, selection, training, and performance appraising. So but when you use HR analytics, you may use some of the techniques of data mining or artificial intelligence or machine intelligence. So you may get some more details about that. So big data in HRM, the next slide please. So big data provides a broader platform for the recruitment process. For recruitment also, next slide please. Yeah. So nowadays, I think you are aware, for the recruiters, nowadays they ask only the LinkedIn profile, because most of the, the LinkedIn site is a professional site. It is not like a Facebook or a Twitter or anything, whatever you want to upload. On the Facebook, you upload your own videos, your personal materials. And then even there are people who are subscribing for libraries also. They can also access many YouTube material, many things. But mostly it is a mixture of everything. But as a professional site, the LinkedIn site is a professional site. You cannot upload the publicly open, the Facebook data and other data on that. So the recruiters are nowadays asking, what is your LinkedIn ID? Just mention that, from that they collect your data and they started recruiting you. So because you will put all your data related to your qualification, experience, and what you have done, the presentations. So anything you can put it there. You can put your Scopus ID or RSID ID or researcher ID. So this will be helpful for them to easily to see that what you are now. So that way the recruitment process helps for the big data provides the broader platform for the recruitment process. Integrating recruitment with the social networking, HR recruiters can find more information about the applicants, including personal video feature, living conditions, social relationship, your ability, etc., so that the candidate's image becomes more vivid and can recruit the best fit. So that way, this is very much helpful. With the advent of big data, information access and sharing have become more convenient. Employees can easily search and find the information they want to learn through the network at any time or anywhere. Sophisticated software can help HR professional record of studied behaviors of every employee, how they are studying, the behavior of studying, searching can be found out from that. Big data in HRM, again, continue. Performance management. So HR professionals can record daily workload. What is your workload given? How you are performing? The specific content of the work and the task achieved, whatever your achievements of each employee. So using cloud-based technology. Nowadays, because same, if you take an example of L&T, it is in many places. On cloud, they can work. They can specify how many employees are working at the site of New Delhi or Bhopal or Madras or Calcutta. So they can find out how many HRs are there, how many engineers are there. So they can find out the specific type of people who are all working, what type of activity is given. So on the cloud-based technology also, they can collect data and analyze it. The performance can be evaluated. Maybe some site in some place, people are working very fast, then you can utilize them in a better manner. So finally, according to the pay performance standards, salaries can be calculated also. By evaluating the performance, salaries can be increased or increments can be given. Some method of giving benefits to the employees. Sophisticated HR software that performs these operations not only improves work efficiency, it also reduces enterprise investment. So when you find a better person, so you can, you need not employ many more people because you can utilize the persons who are already working very well with you. So it is known as talent analytics. So education industry, including libraries, the transformation by big data motivated many changes. So customized programs and schemes. So you can customize some of the programs to benefit individual students that can be created using the data collected on the basis of each student's learning history. So each student's learning history, you can try to customize some program, use some program. You can find out what each person is doing. So by that, you can try to improve their, you can give some data, whatever is required for them. That way, the overall student's performance can be increased. Reframing the course material. Similarly, that's what collection management. According to the data, see, many times you will find many books are not available in the book, or many journals which are not available. Many students complain, I need this type of articles, I am not finding here. Every time I have to request you on interlibrary loan, or I have to go to some other library. So these things can be, you can collect all those things and project your organization and then reframe the materials or the resources that is collected on the basis of what a student learned and to what extent by real-time monitoring on the components of a course is beneficial for the student. Similarly, that is the course materials. So you are finding a lot of course materials nowadays freely available also. You can try to give the link for all those things to your students. So even though everywhere MBA course is there, for example, because now I am in management institute, so MBA is there, HR, MBA marketing, MBA finance, MBA strategic medicine. So, but the course materials need not be the same. Maybe some of the books are followed same, but the teachers, I mean the professors, the associate professors who teaches, the method of teaching changes. You know, they may not be able to get what they are supposed to actually get. So you can give some of the links, whatever is freely available, you know, by, you know, NPTEL is there, you can have a link, minimal level. And there are management websites are there at the international level also, you can give a link. Some of the management institutes which are giving the materials freely on the website, even free books are available, management books. People are interested to download. You can give the links for that, you know. So that will be helpful for the students. Reframing the course material. So new advancement in grading systems that have been introduced as a result of analysis. So the grading system changes because of this new environment. Appropriate analysis and study of every student's record. That will help understand each student's progress, strength and weakness, interest, and many more. So by using any of these mechanisms, so we can find out the progress and strength and weakness of the interest of the student. It would help in determining which career would be the most suitable. Even we can tell them this type of career will be better for you after completing this course. Benefits from big data. Slide is not coming. Now. Slide is not there. Benefits from big data. Big data can bring about dramatic cost reductions, substantial improvements. No, slide is not there. Slide is there. Benefits from big data. Yeah. Big data can bring about dramatic cost reductions, substantial improvements in the time to perform computing tasks or new product or service offerings. It also supports internal business decisions because it is mainly meant for, big data is analysis mainly for decisions only, whether it is internally or externally or for the whole organization, it supports. So big data is timely, accessible, holistic, trustworthy, relevant, secure, authoritative, and actionable. So better decision making increases the productivity, reduces the cost, improves the customer service, increases revenue, greater innovation, and faster speed to do the activity. That also benefits the big data analytics. So some of the problems identified with the library big data. Because being in library science, I just want to mention some of them. Next slide, please. The big data in the library. Problems identified with the library big data. So big data in the library is different from other data fields like hospitals and business. You know, hospitals, big data is something different because their doctor collects the data from the images because they want to analyze things. So in the business environment, as what type of people are coming and buying what things. So, but in a library environment, the data is different. So these big data definitely have problems for processing, transformation, analysis, and presentation. As the amount of data increasing very fast beyond our knowledge and capacity, there is a challenge in capturing, storing, sharing, transferring, analyzing, and visualizing all those unstructured, structured, or semi-structured data. So the data is in different format, as we have seen, structured and semi-structured and unstructured. It's very difficult if you are not able to collect on a timely basis. So in order to apply big data techniques in library, some more work should be done, but not limited to central data repositories. So you may create a central data repositories where data is stored and maintained and cataloged. Similarly, data standards should try to follow, to which collected data should follow data communities which collect, maintain, and curate the data. Curation means analyzing and finding out what is relevant data is kept and analyze the tool. Some more problems. Capgemini, there is a company called Capgemini. It identifies some of the issues. Next slide, please. Pranav, next slide, please. Capgemini identifies some of the issues like lacking of data analysts. Because data analysts have come into picture only very recently. So very difficult to get data analysts. The Capgemini itself says, data analysts need not only have the skills of statistics and computer science, they should also have the skills of domain knowledge. That is very important. And collaboration ability. See, unless there is a collaboration or cooperation among the people, it's very difficult to get the actual data and analyze and even get the output of that. So the challenges faced by librarians are the ability to manage the information of big data. So managing the information is very difficult in the big data environment. It seems that short course training might not be sufficient. If you have a short-term course, that may not be sufficient. Maybe you may have to do a full-time course on big data analytics. So ability of adopting big data, that comes in various fields. More than half of organizations could not handle the big data currently due to lack of personnel and platform. So lack of personnel is the main problem. And then platform is the availability of hardware and software. So research of library big data is even much slower than that in other disciplines. So compared to other disciplines, in library, it is not at all moving up. So very slowly, I think Library of Congress is doing something. British Library is doing some data business, big data analytics nowadays. So due to digital libraries tend to be self-sufficient, self-contained organizational units, and they try to stay back from the new technology. So they feel that they provide the digital library and IR that is sufficient for the people to have. And from that, they can go on. I mean, the users can utilize all the facilities. So that is not the actual thing. So you can identify many more things from the digital library also, what they are searching, what is the way they are going on, what is the research they are interested, what type of resources they are interested. So many more things can be found out and the big data facility can be utilized. And another one is always the libraries having the budget issues. You know, every organization, the budget is given for the library only the last. So investment are needed for analytics servers. You know, you have to buy servers, high performance computing servers. Library administrations have not yet placed big data due to shrinking budgets. So research data managed by projects are paid less attention due to the challenge of human resources. Again, there are technical challenges. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. technical challenges. Big data involves techniques such as capturing the data. You know, there is a lot of techniques required for capturing different type of data. You know, it is not just scanning or getting data by software, just whatever is running, capture it and make it available in Excel or the analysis format, you know, storing them, processing and presenting those data. So libraries have different types of data, might be in various stages, like waiting for digitalization. Large set of data often contains some dirty or false data. Therefore, correctly removing those data needs some work. Due to heterogeneous types and formats of research data, integrating them become a very tough job. Many types of research data are considerably less usable when they are in their raw state than after they have had filters or algorithms or other processing performed on the data. Those work need budget. So there is a requirement of budget, and the tools are required. Privacy, another one is security. You know, big data is mining, that's data mining, the data and discovering knowledge. There should be a privacy issue, that is data security. That has not been well considered for the library big data concept. Because the library data is an open data, almost you can say it's not that much of confidential data. But when somebody is doing research in chemical laboratory, he does a lot of things and create a lot of data every day and he notes down in a system. So that is a somewhat secrecy. You know, he may find out some new material, new medicine or any new invention. So that is there is a security issue is involved in the big data. So they spend money and keep it very safely. But in a library environment, it is still the importance is not given for the privacy. Tremendous scope for big data analytics. There's a lot of scope. Even some library science people ask me, what is the scope for me in the future? I always suggest, try to do big data science or data science course. That is fetching a lot of jobs nowadays or in future also. So that way there is a tremendous scope for big data analytics in every field and especially in HR. To use big data potentially, we need people with skills to use those tools to turn those hidden insights into meaningful information. When right people with the right skill will analyze the big data at the right time, then the actual value of the big data will flow. So to conclude, use and adoption of big data is beneficial and allows efficiencies in terms of cost, productivity, and innovation. Librarians have always been great at information organization and management and try to have basic knowledge of how various software tools that can perform for big data. So give rise to complex visualizations regarding patterns and trends in human behavior and interactions with applications in data mining, because we are always doing some way of searching. So data mining will help there. Data curation, that means removing the unwanted data, and the research data management. Nowadays, you are finding everywhere data management courses are going on. So libraries are at the forefront of such initiatives with administrative and technological support from their universities or institutions. However, there are many limitations in data management that must be addressed through research and development in a variety of areas. So the collected big data must be properly used and analyzed for HR analytics, including recruitment of LIS professionals, collection development, preparation of repositories, having more collections as per the users' demand from the different types of resources, including open and subscribed databases, so information literacy, and the use of e-discovery tools. So I think thank you. Thank you very much for having given me an opportunity. Trinao. Yeah, back.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, finish.
Sir, now this is a sir question. Today we received more than 10 questions. By our YouTube comment section. Rajan.
Yes, I am hearing.
The first question.
Yes, I am here.
How big data can be implemented in academic library?
In academic library. Just now I was telling, starting from the collection development.
How to implement big data
See, starting from the collection development itself, we can utilize the big data concept. You know how the users are accessing the collection, whether it is frequently, what is their demand. So we identify and collect the data, and how they are searching. You know, during searching, we can identify whether what type of journals they are accessing or what type of books they are accessing. From that, we can collect data and then make a big data analytics. So there are tools are required. It is not just by collecting data. Use of big data analytical tools are required for analyzing and finding and then implementing the collection development. In other way also for searching databases, you know, you can also identify the student or faculty's interest and their research, what they are doing, in what way the libraries can improve by understanding their searching behavior or their visits to the library or their visit to the databases. So through that we can identify that. So that way the academic library can slightly give the importance to the big data. Haji, yes.
Thank you, sir. The next question. Yeah. How big data helps in employee productivity and retention?
Employees productivity and retention. Yeah, we are also analyzing the employees function, you know, in the HRM, we are looking these all the HR related activities, you know, like say planning, recruitment, selection and training and performance, you know. So then the performance appraisal, you know, there is a performance appraisal is there that we can have a data, see what one or 2% data. You can take even group of people data. You can identify in what way he is contributing to the organization. See, you have been assigned. I mean, that person has been given some job. You can give some time. How he is utilizing the tools and techniques given to him. Then, is he performing well or not? So, in what way he is improving the organization. For retaining him, you can identify whether he is suitable or not. The performance can be measured in many ways, you know. Every year, actually, the supervisor can give some comments. There are power forms are filled, you know, every 6 months or every 1 year, as per the organization, there is a form which is filled by the employee, what he has done for the previous 6 months or 3 months. So by that also, he can that employee can be evaluated. The performance can be evaluated. He has done on timely basis. Whether any benefit for that when he has done the on timely. Or he has given some innovative ideas for that to improve that activity, what is given to him. So that way you can find out the performance and then try to retain him. That's why people are given the benefits of bonus or increment, other things. So that way that can be done by using big data. So big data has to be collected. See, the way what is he doing, that data has to be collected. Yeah, next one.
Thank you, sir. Next question.
Yeah.
Does library will make a unique role in big data management?
Unique role is difficult nowadays because it will take time. See, unless otherwise librarians read the big data analytics. It's even now I am telling you, even British Library and Library of Congress, a portion of them only they are doing the big data analytics. It's not completely involved. So it will take time. And it cannot be alone by using big data library can function. That will take maybe 10 years, 15 years time.
Sir, next question.
Yeah.
Is how data science will be useful to library users?
Data science. I am not telling data science is useful for library users. If you can study, you know, the data science or research data management courses, that will be useful because nowadays we are finding the big data jobs or data science courses data management jobs are available. I am not relating data science to libraries.
Okay, so the next question, in which application we can use the library operations, big data?
I think people started from the Adobe only in the very beginning. Even DRTC did some activities for big data using Hadoop tools. Hadoop, H-A-D-O-O-P. Hadoop software. So nowadays there are many more tools have come because that was the open source. Even now there are many open source tools are there. So Hadoop is the best, I think. Now maybe some more new tools must have come. I am not aware. Yes, Mr. Venkatramani wants to ask something.
Okay, how it is useful for collection planning, collection development?
Yeah, I was telling in the session also many times about collection development. See, you get the collection development, how the collection is improved in a library. First, you get the intent from the departments or the head of the institutions or from the students. So you analyze those things, whether it is actually required, whether any duplicates are there or not. You do all those things. If it is in a machine readable format, you know also, and how the faculty is coming and utilizing the resource, what is already existing. The same document is used by many number of people, whether it is actually required, so we can buy more number of copies also. Even students demand. Sometimes we say only 5 copies are there. Maybe that 5 copies is not sufficient. The teacher or students, they may ask multiple copies. So we can identify those things and we can try to improve the collection. The other way also, I told you, suppose you are advertising that these are the books we want to purchase and you give a quotation. Many publishers give you the quotations to you. Then within that, you may find some more related books are also coming there, which you must have missed. Say publishers may quote always beyond what you ask. You see, if I ask only knowledge management books I need, they may give you knowledge sharing books, they may give knowledge transfer, they may give business BPR, no, business process re-engineering. That's also part of knowledge management. So they may give related subjects books also. By that, you can also circulate your faculty or head of the department or the chairman or whoever is the authority or the library committee first. So they can decide also to improve the collection. They can also feel, okay, this will be useful for our institute. That way the collection can be improved also. So collection development can be done in many ways. I have written an article, Collection Development 2.0. The even use of Facebook helps for the collection development. In British Library, in some 5 libraries, I gave the example. It was published in Mizoram, in a book actually. Mizoram Manoj Kumar Sinha published one book. I gave a book chapter on collection to collection development 2.0 for libraries.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Next question, what is the role of big data in research work?
Research work is very much essential. No? So research is the one which is the base for any organization to improve, particularly industry. Even in the academic environment, see, faculties are doing research. So students are doing research. So that way they can identify what is already in the same field, what is done everywhere. They can analyze, they can find out, they can relate what is already done in the same subject at different places and then modify according to your need, as per your organization's objective or as per your university's interest, or it is an industry, as per the industry's choice. So they can change and they can do the research. So that way the data can be collected, no? Big data can be collected and analyzed. I mean, the main purpose is for the big data is collecting the similar research, you know, the research whatever is available in that field, and analyze that and get what is more relevant to you and identify whether such type of research is done here or slightly adding or modifying, we can do a research on that aspect in our organization. So that way it will be helpful for the research environment. Yes.
Okay, thank you, sir. That's all the questions are over, sir.
Okay, thank you very much.
Nityanandam, sir. Nityanandam, sir.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Hello.
Nityanandam, sir, we can. Hello. We can. Ma'am.
Hello. Yes. Sir, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, we can hear you and we can see you.
Yes. Hello. Yes, madam.
Just talk. Proceed.
Sariya kekkala enakku.
And professor Nadra.
382 registration.
Thank you one and all for participating in the 13th webinar organized by Madras Library Association and this is I thank the reserve. Hello,
technically she coming a person
I thank the resource person Dr. M. Natarajan for sharing his insight knowledge on big data. I thank the organizing team, Mr. Tirunavagasu, Dr. Nityanandam, Dr. Suresh, Mr. Venkatramani and others. Thank all the participants and organizing team to make this 13th webinar in great success. Thank you one and all.
Namaste for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye, sir.
Bye, sir.
Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, sir. Bye, s